Tom Sullivan, a developer and organizer here in the Great Falls area, an associate professor at the College of Great Falls, and Edward Lemire, the executive director of the Native American Center. Gentlemen, Hollywood has for years portrayed Native Americans in the role of the war bonnets charging down the trail. Is this really a gross misrepresentation of Native Americans?
I think it's a gross misrepresentation of Native Americans. And I got a story that I talk about when I was a child, and I'd watched some of these movies. And one in particular was a John Wayne movie where the Indians were attacking the wagon train. And I remember as kids, we acted it out, and we chose up sides for cowboys and Indians, and I always got to be the Indian because I was Indian and I wanted to be. But it was our job to run through the schoolyard and torment the little girls, and it was the job of the other kids in the school, which were mostly white, to chase after us. And finally, they would track us down and they would shoot us, and I could die better than anybody, and I took pride in the way I died, but I didn't realize the implications that was going to have on my life as to who and what an Indian was.
Ed, let me come to you and ask, what are we doing here in Great Falls at the Native American Center?
Well, Dave, we're doing a number of things this year that we have wanted to do for a number of years, but we've never had the opportunity. And one of the most important things that I think that we're trying to do this year is with Tom's program, and that is with community development and organizing. We've recognized the problems that Indian people have had in the city of Great Falls for many years, but we have not had the opportunity or the funding or the resources to do anything more than just apply a band-aid to the problem. This year, the federal government, through the Administration for Native Americans, did make some funds available to urban Indian organizations such as ours, and we were successful in applying for some of those funds. Consequently, we've hired Mr. Sullivan here to work in the area of community development, hopefully to educate the Indian community to the importance of becoming involved in the community processes, the importance of registering and voting, and hopefully making the Indian person aware of the importance of taking charge of their own lives.
Tom, a couple of weeks ago on our nightly report, we covered part of that story of the process that you're starting. Let's talk about particularly your role, not just with the Native American Center, but at the college itself. And people at home might be very interested, you know, to find out that, you know, there are people who are really concerned about the problems not only here, but around our state.
Mm-hmm. Well, I kind of want to... I'm an assistant professor at the College of Great Falls, okay, and I work with a number of Native American students. There's about 50 of them. And as community organizer and developer for the Native American Center, it's my job to go out into the community and bring as many of the Native American people, but also other community people, into the Indian Center. And the Native American population here is unique in that during the 50s, there was the United States government had a policy of enticing the Indians off the reservation and bringing them into the cities, where they promised them jobs and they promised them a whole lot of different things. Well, there were thousands of these Indians that came to the cities in the 50s, and as a result of this, they really didn't find the jobs or the lifestyle that they were hoping for. Most of them ended up in the rat-infested ghettos. A good many of them, because they lack the education and the technology, have just never been able to get into the technological world where they should be. They kind of, I guess the best way to explain it is the urban Indian sits between three worlds. He sits in the rat-infested ghetto where he sees from a distance his true identity on the reservation, and he sees a rich glittering world which he can't quite get to because he doesn't have the technological experience or the education. A lot of this came about during the 50s when they enticed the Indians off of the reservation.
All right, let's come back. You've touched on the idea of the reservation life today and in the past. Have things improved any? Are they getting the education that's necessary out there at all? Ed, you might want to address that.
There are a lot more opportunities available to the Indian person now who wants to get out and seek or take advantage of those opportunities. The problem we're seeing with our present economy now is the fact that a lot of these people who are obtaining their college degrees, skills that they need to compete in the present world, are not able to find jobs just because of the present economy. Mm-hmm. They have, one other thing that also concerns me is the fact that under the present administration, I believe that equal employment opportunity is also falling way behind, and this seems to be a concern of a lot of the minorities in the nation. We have the laws in place, however, they're not being enforced.
All right. Is part of that, though, what Tom was saying, that basically that maybe the Native American has not been able to keep up with education to get some of those positions? Is that a part of it, as well as the law?
Most certainly that is a part of it. I believe that within the last 10 years, the Indian people have made great strides in education. However, there is still a lot lacking in that area.
Mm-hmm. Then how do we enforce the law, then, to go with that?
That is a question that I can't answer you. I believe that the law is in place. However, the agencies that enforce those laws are experiencing budget cuts, which results in fewer personnel to monitor those laws that are in place.
Mm-hmm. The resolution program for Native Americans is what we've been talking about, and since its formation, the government has been trying to assimilate Native Americans into the white society itself. Just very quickly, has it really worked, Tom?
No, it hasn't. It hasn't worked. As a matter of fact, I would say that the good number of Native Americans, when they come into the city, they really end up in a culture shock. I mean, here they are denied access to their world and the things that they believe in, and they can't get to that other world quite. And consequently, you have a shockwave of listless, apathetic, and doubtful feelings to come on. And the Indian begins to drift further and further from the norms of not only the Indian world, but also the non-Indian world. And he begins to wonder who he is. Is there a purpose to life after all? Listless, apathetic, doubtful feelings come on. He drifts further and further away from these social norms of behavior.
Okay, is it through programs like yours and the Native American Center that says, hey, come on back, let's look at the problem realistically today, and here's some things we can do?
I think it is. I think that the idea is that we're trying to combine both worlds and bring them together, and to bring about an adjustment for the Native American in society, to bring them up to the par with the rest of society. You know, we have something like over 50% of the population is unemployed in the Indian community. I mean, this is a big concern to put Indian people to work of the Native American Center.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's talk then a little bit more. Part of the program, and some of the things I've heard, is for the Indian children particularly, this is a trap set early in life by experiencing that poverty. How do you say, well, here's what we want you to do, and as Tom has said, looking out there at the community and saying, well, how do I get a house? How can I get involved in this community? What does the Native Center do to help that?
Well. I think that is a process which has to start at a very early age, and possibly in the first and second grade. Now, when we're talking about the general community or the non-Indian community at large, we're not necessarily saying that the Indian person should strive for that sort of life, the lifestyle where you have a big fancy home and you have two car garage and all of this stuff. We're not saying that every Indian person wants that lifestyle. However, those Indian people who do choose or would like to have that lifestyle, we are stressing to them very strongly that they're going to have to acquire the skills and the education which will be necessary for them to compete in that world if that's the lifestyle that they choose.
Is there anything wrong with that lifestyle for Native Americans?
Some Native Americans feel that there is, really, and they don't identify very strongly with it. I think that there are a lot of Indian people who would rather maintain the major portion of their traditional culture and still be able to earn a decent living for their family.
There's what's called here the Native American Conflict Resolution Program. This is kind of what we've been touching on here. Tom, want to explain some more about that?
Certainly. The North American Indian Resolution Council is made up of Indian students and non-Indian students of the College of Great Falls and the surrounding community. And we meet once a week and we discuss Native American issues. And more than that, we not only discuss them, we try to reach resolutions that we can go by and solve some of these problems, hopefully.
Mm-hmm. We'll come back and we'll talk a little bit more about that in just a little bit. But, and I suppose the thing is that when we have a Native American center, is it being used as it could be by Native Americans? And?
I'm not sure I understand your question.
Are Native Americans taking full advantage of what the programs that Tom has been working on and what the center can do and can be helpful to them?
Definitely. In addition to the program that Tom works for, we also administer several other programs at the center. We also administer an employment and training program and a health program for those Indian people who meet the eligibility criteria. In administering those programs, we try to obtain as much coordination between programs so that we don't have a lot of people off working one area and forgetting about what the other people are doing in another area. So we're doing our best to coordinate all of the services of the program so that we can enhance the overall self-sufficiency efforts of Indian people.
Would you say that based on the population within this city or from, let's say, even far as Browning, that there's a significant percentage or a small percentage or a larger percentage? How do you judge that? That are people who are coming to the Native Center and saying, hey, yeah, I want to be trained and I need some health care services, etc.
Well, we presently have approximately 2,000 active files in our health program alone. With the funds that are given to us for our employment and training program, obviously we can't help every person that comes to the center. We always have more applications for employment and training services than we are able to serve. We always have to work within the confines of a budget. But we are seeing more and more people moving to urban areas. Obviously, this is because of the cutbacks in federal programs and excuse me, the high unemployment rates on the reservations.
Mm-hmm. Let me just ask: can a Native American go to job service and get some help there?
Yes, they can.
All right, so that's not excluded to them, and I would not want that to be misleading to anybody there that's saying, well, gee, we're discriminating right there alone. Mm-hmm. So they can go and get some help in that alternative as well.
Yes.
I suppose that when you look at the whole situation, particularly with the Native American Center, are you trying to reach out to, with your programs, Tom, to get people to come in and say, hey, look what's available?
Well, I think that my primary job with the Native American Center as community organizer and developer is to see that all the community, you know, not only the Indian, but especially the Indian, has access to the Native American Center and the services that they offer. But we also want to be of service to other agencies in the community.
Mm-hmm.
And it's my job to go out and to bring in as many people as I can possibly bring into that Native American Center and see that we're busy all the time. It's a big job that needs to be done out there.
Mm-hmm. I guess the question from my standpoint, I'm a white man, could I come to the center and would you say, well, gee, come and help in some way? Would you invite people to come in and participate and to help?
Definitely. We do invite people to come to the center. As a matter of fact, pretty soon we're going to have a policy where we take people through the center and we introduce them around. We show them, you know, just exactly what we're doing. We're talking about Indian and non-Indian for our center. Our services can be of great help. Let me give you an example. In the North American Indian Resolution Council, we were recently contacted because there was a person that was in the hospital, was terribly sick, and they were Indian, and nobody could speak to this person. So they called and they asked if there was some way we could get a hold of somebody who could speak the Indian language so they could communicate with this person, and immediately we were able to find somebody. These are the kind of services. When social service agencies have problems concerning Indians, they can turn also to the Native American Center. They can turn to the North American Indian Resolution Council. We want to be of help. We want to be of service to the community.
We'll be right right back to talk more about the Resolution Council on Cloverdale. Tom Sullivan is back with us, and joining him is Donna Gentry. And I want to come back before we start in to talk about the Resolutions Council, Thomas, to come back and focus just a little bit more on the forum that you've been working on that has already taken, part of it's been taking place already.
The public forum. When the North American Indian Resolution Council was first forming, we got a great deal of feedback from the Native American community, not only the Native American community, but I'd have to say low-income people in general. Mm-hmm. And they expressed a great deal of hope in the council. And then they would go on and they would express the frustrations that they were feeling in a number of areas. They were experiencing a great deal of frustration in the criminal justice area, drug and alcohol abuse, health, housing, rehabilitation, discrimination, unemployment, minority enterprise, voter registration, education, leadership, welfare. They were experiencing a great deal of frustration in each of these areas. And as we were going along, we began to realize that we couldn't hear each of them individually because there were so many of them, that we decided that we would hold a public forum. The other thing that came through loud and clear was the great deal of fear that was being experienced in the community. And fear is kind of a, if you look at fear, generally it's something that when we don't have control over a certain person, place, thing, or event, if we don't have control over that, that upsets us. And it makes the people angry. It makes us angry inside. So one of the ideas of the public forum is to get people to verbalize it. And when you can verbalize it, then you begin to get a picture of what it is you're afraid of. And once you begin to get a picture of it, you can educate yourself as to that fear. For example, criminal justice. People who've never been involved in criminal justice are simply overwhelmed. They know that judge can send them away for a long time, and their loved ones know that, and they're very frightened. So the idea of the public forum is to get them to come out and express those feelings and begin a process of education. We're going to have another public forum here, I think, on May 17th, and this time it's going to be at Gibson Park at 1 o'clock, and it'll be probably until 4 or 5, and it's going to be a picnic type of public forum. And the issues that we're going to be covering are rehabilitation, discrimination, unemployment, and minority enterprise, all very heavy issues in the community at this time.
You've talked on these forums, first of all, as I remember, the first one focused pretty much on voting and registration, that type of a process, being a participating citizen. The second one was pretty much, as you said, on criminal justice, and had really an outstanding panel to communicate back and forth with, is that right?
Right. Yeah, there were. And there were two public forums. Yesterday, the Indian Action Council also had a public forum, and they had the sheriff there, and they had the chief of police, and a number of other people who were also participating in it. And it's a beginning of the educating the public as to what's going on in the criminal justice system.
Is the suspicion by many Native Americans that the criminal justice favors the white rather than the Indian, is that a suspicion, or is that really true?
I think it's probably true. I think when they look at the sentencing that Native Americans are getting, it's much more severe for Native Americans than it is for others. If you look at the people who are in the prisons, the percentage of Native Americans is much more than any other group. The other thing is also that low-income people, it seems like those people who can afford lawyers don't go to jail. There's a small percentage that do. But those people who are appointed attorneys, the prisons are full with people who've been appointed attorneys.
All right. I guess the question is, why more Native Americans? Is it just because they are low income? Is it because that they have grown up that way? I mean, there's got to be some more behind that. Or is it just the criminal justice system is bad?
Well, I believe the criminal justice system needs to be really reworked.
Okay, but I think we've all talked about there have been some problems, though. And
economic problems.
Where does it start? I mean, there's got to be some problems with the individual. I mean, we've talked about that already in the program. How do we start to bring that around? Is it with the young people themselves?
Right. I think the answer is to get to the young people, get to them before they get set in their ways. The youth program, the North American Indian Resolution Council is starting a youth program, and maybe Donna would want to comment on the youth program.
Donna sat there very quietly so far. Let's talk about the North American Resolution Council, the constitution of the college, the youth programs, etc. Donna, why don't you just kind of jump in at this point?
Okay. The North American Indian Resolution Council is right now consisting of about 50 people, Indian and non-Indian people. And we work in clans. And we counsel every Friday at noon. and we discuss the issues at hand. Sometimes it takes well over an hour to try to come to any type of judgments on things, but we are working really hard on a youth program right now because we do believe that if we start with the youth, then they'll gain some respect for the law and then respect for themselves and give them their own sense of responsibility. And with this youth program, we also hope for all of us to be involved, have them come to us and tell us what their needs are, you know, and then it will be a good experience for all of us, actually. But right now, we're just in the process of getting it together. Mm-hmm. The clans.
You're using a word there that may be foreign to some people. What's a clan?
A clan is, we're broken into clans. There's six clans.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have the eagle, we have the hawk, turtle, bear, wolf, and the deer. And there are families.
Okay, a family unit.
A family unit,
all
yes.
Right.
When something is brought to the council, they tell us what their problem is or what their ideas are, and then we go into discussions. The hawk and the eagle will sit on one side of the room and we will discuss the problem or an issue, and then we will turn it over. We will tell across the room to the deer and the wolf what our viewpoint is, and then they will discuss their viewpoint, and then they will return it. Either they will agree or they will bring up things that maybe they find have not been submitted yet. Okay, and then when they complete their discussion, then it is turned over to the bear clan and the turtle clan. But normally the bear and the turtle do not have any say.
Tom, you want to jump in here?
Yeah, I wanted to. The best way for me to describe it is that this form of government was based on the Haudenosaunee, the Iroquois Confederation, and they conceived it over 1,000 years ago. And it was between warring nations who were almost killing each other off, and then we had a peacemaker who came and gave them this form of government. Well, we've used that portions of that form of government, and the best way to explain it is, in the United States government is also patterned after the Haudenosaunee, and how it works is we break into three groups, and it would be similar to the Senate and to the Congress and to the Supreme Court. But the difference is that we all must agree on an issue rather than majority. And each house breaks down and they discuss it amongst themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And
go ahead.
Well, then I was going to say, as they discuss it amongst themselves, I have no say in it. You know, mm-hmm. Once it's presented, and nobody else has a say in those particular discussions, and then the decisions are brought out into the council.
All right. Now, what kinds of cases would this governing body hear?
Anything. Any problem that anyone in the community has or something that they would like us to be involved with. We've had several people come address our council and just discuss maybe a problem that they've had in the community or a family problem. It doesn't matter. People have come to us and talk to us, and then we'll do what we can do. If it is possible for us to come to help them in any way, we will.
Can non-Indians attend?
Oh, non-Indians are members.
Okay, and is that usual?
Well, it's important for our group to have non-Indians participating. We also want this to be a whole cultural experience, not only for the Indian, but also for the non-Indian. We want this to be a sharing experience.
Mm-hmm. How would one, do they just show up at noontime and say, I want to join? Obviously
No. We have an adoption procedure, and if they know someone in the council already, then that clan will pretty much, they'll discuss what this person can do for the clan. Actually, all they have to do is sign a paper and really want to work with it, because there is a lot of work to be done. We all work very hard. There's mm-hmm. at least 50 people, and we all have a lot of work that we do. And it's all volunteer.
Donna, is there an age group that's required? Do you have to attend the College of Great Falls?
No.
Is there any requirements? What would be some, anyone can come, any age?
Any age, any person, if just showing an interest in wanting to help and knowing that you're volunteering your time and that you're going to work.
All right. Now, let's, and we've got several minutes remaining here, now let's put all of this back into perspective of where Native American programs are going in this community and maybe even in the state. Tom?
Mm-hmm. Well, I I think that Native American community is really beginning to organize, and they're developing strengths in areas that they've never had strengths before. The fact that we have approximately this semester 10 Native American students are going to graduate from the college with bachelor's degrees in education. Unfortunately, there's no work for them in education at this point. That's where we're hoping that the youth program is going to come in. We don't want to see this talent being scattered out and losing. We'd like to keep this talent right in the Indian community. They've put a lot of time in school. They've got a lot of training going. They have a lot to offer the community. And that's what we're hoping for in the youth program. However, we have no funding. You know, and that's going to be one of the obstacles we have to overcome. And it's part of the Resolution Council to go out and seek funding.
And that's going to be a big job. Donna, are you going to be involved in that?
Oh, of course. I'm involved in every aspect of it. Mm-hmm. We do have people that will say, well, if an issue comes up, then it's on a volunteer basis. You say, well, I would like to work with that. You know, you don't have to. You can be in the council and not do anything. Or you can, you know, something will come up sooner or later where you want to be involved because it feels good to you. And so you're going to work for it.
We're hoping that to get the youth center located near one of the local facilities, you know, for example, the Heisey Center. We've been talking with them. We're hoping that we might be able to use their facility 3 times a week during the summertime, in which we can have basketball. They have an arts and crafts room. We can start a boxing team. These are all big, and different Indian sports. These are all big in the Indian community, and we want to get these out. But we not only want Indian children, we also want their friends to come along too, so they can be experienced for both of them.
I would say that I wish you well with this project. I hope the program has had a chance to let the people at home understand a little bit more of the role of the Native American Center, the Resolution Council, as well as your work, Tom, at the College of Great Falls as an organizer and developer in this community. And I want to thank you both for joining us on Close Up Great Falls. I'm David Denault, and we thank you for joining us in this program of the Native American Center. The Indian Day in Great Falls began with a luncheon to benefit youth activities at the Native American Center. The center held an open house to make the community more aware of the services the center provides. And Tom Sullivan, the community organizer, spoke with News 5 about what this day means to Native Americans.
Well, President Reagan has designated today as Native American Day, and what we're doing is we're giving recognition to the Native Americans and all the many contributions they have given the world, which are many.
Tomorrow, the center will hold a public forum for Native Americans.
At the public forum will run from 1 to 3 o'clock, and we'll be discussing the issues that will be covered will be rehabilitation, discrimination, minority enterprise, and unemployment. And then immediately following that, we will have the memorial feed. And I might say that the memorial feed costs nothing, and the public is invited. And there are a number of people in the community that have donated turkeys and given their time and stuff. So the memorial feed is for free, and it's a time when we come together and we pray and we give thanks to the Creator for all He's given us, and we give thanks for all our relatives who have come to this world and have gone on.
In making the proclamation, President Reagan said the story of the Indian in America is a record of endurance, of survival and adaptation and creativity in the face of overwhelming obstacles. David Denault, News 5. Today, and Robert Gopher, a Native American, talked about the customs of fasting.
Is that it is mandatory requirement for the Native Americans, as I stated, this way of life for the past 18 years, that when you worship God in a love of Him, in a fast, that the rule number one is that you have to love His creation truly from your heart. That means the human race.
A memorial feed honoring those who have died and passed on was also held today. Community developer and organizer Tom Sullivan said one of the greatest gifts the Indians gave was democracy.
The Haudenosaunee, their gift probably to the world and the greatest gift of all was democracy. They had pure democracy. And I believe the way they govern themselves is many Indian nations can learn from. The United States government is patterned after the Haudenosaunee. The way that the United States government reaches its laws is designed right after the Iroquois Confederation.
Some Great Falls residents were awakened this morning to the tune of March.
For Montana Native Americans, Indian country is seen one Sunday of each month.
Greetings, I'm Darnell Dorr, your hostess for Indian Country for the month of May 1983. Throughout Indian Country, powwows are beginning to be the big event for each of the colleges, and last month we interviewed several students from various college Native American Studies centers throughout the state. This month we have with us guests from the College of Great Falls that are representing the Native American Indian Resolution Council. They are Sharon Running Wolf and Roberta Dunbar, both elementary ed graduates or just completing graduation school here in Great Falls. And they will be talking about the publicity of their upcoming powwow, which will be